Behold, I will gather them out of all countries whither I have driven them, and I will bring them again unto this place, and I will cause them to dwell safely, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. Thus the words of Jeremiah the prophet, echoing through the corridors of time, reached its fruition. Worn and wearied, persecuted beyond all human belief, a people driven by sheer desperation sought a new home in a new land, a land where they could be free, free from persecution, tyranny, and prejudice, a home to forget the past and begin life anew. But that long-cherished dream of setting foot on their promised land is to be denied. The British have been ordered to turn them all back. With tears of desperation, they fight and plead to remain. But instead, the children of Israel, who endured so much for so long, are turned away in this hour of greatest need. They came so close to the promised land that now all hope is left behind. The refusal of the British to admit these exiles became the last straw for the Haganah underground movement. Terrorist activities increased in tempo until finally the problem is turned over to the UN General Assembly. After a long and stormy discussion, the UN finally agreed to take a vote as to whether or not to partition Palestine into a Jewish and Arab state. In Palestine, on the day of the vote, there's a curious silence in the streets. It is a day of waiting and of prayer. For this day could mean that Israel might once again have a home.
Afghanistan, no. Argentina, Argentina, abstention. Australia.
UN session is being transmitted to Palestine, where huddled over their radios, the people are avidly following the counts.
Soviet Union, yes. United Kingdom, abstain. The United States, yes. Four, six, two.
The resolution of the Committee for Palestine was adopted by 33 votes.
At last, there will be a Jewish state. May 14, 1948, David Ben-Gurion read the Declaration of Independence for the new state of Israel. However, at that very moment, Israel was surrounded. At midnight, Arab League troops struck. The Arabs vowed the total annihilation of the infant nation. Israel stood alone, one nation against six. But the young country's love of freedom was great. Her people, who only wanted peace, took up the weapons of war. Israel came under siege, held fast, and struck back. The astonished world saw the Arabs defeated on all fronts. Israel emerged victorious, gaining one-third more land than was allocated under the UN partition. War broke out again, however, in October of 1956, when Nasser blocked Israeli passage through the Suez Canal. Within a week, France and England intervened on the side of Israel. French troops parachuted on the canal zone, while British invasion units waited ashore below. Nasser suffered his worst defeat since coming to power. Israel again became the victor, and again extended her borders. As the years pass, Nasser again begins to speak of still another war with Israel. And then in 1967, the Egyptian leader blockaded the Gulf of Aqaba to Israeli shipping and declared, "We are ready for war." At dawn, the 5th of June, 1967, the war broke out. The well-trained Israeli Air Force quickly silenced the Egyptian airfields together with their aircraft. At the same time, the Navy took to the seas. The Israeli armored divisions roared into Sinai. The attacking Egyptian armies were quickly overrun by the well-trained and disciplined Israeli forces. Israel faced an enemy of 14 Arab states whose population and armament outnumbered Israel nearly 100-1. And yet what has been proclaimed a modern day miracle, the tiny nation of Israel crushed her enemies in just 6 short days. Thus history records the struggle for the rebirth of a new nation. Looking back on those dramatic days, we might be inclined to attribute Israel's rebirth and survival as a nation to her great determination and resourcefulness as a people. But is it that alone? You recall that Israel has been called God's chosen people, which carries with it the thought that somehow, at some time, they will serve a special purpose and destiny in God's plan. What is that destiny? Well, to find the answer, we need to go to the book that records Israel's past, her present, and even her future. And as we do, we will see that Israel was reborn not by mere chance or cunning or determination alone. No, but because an almighty God promised it would happen and then directed it to take place. Let's look at some of the prophecies regarding Israel. The prophet Jeremiah wrote of the diaspora of Israel some 600 years before it actually took place. Because of unfaithfulness, God said, "Therefore will I hurl you out of this land into the land of which ye had no knowledge, neither ye nor your fathers." And so for nearly 2,000 years, Israel remained dispersed throughout the world without a homeland. But notice how God, through Jeremiah, also prophesied of the return of favor to Israel by their being restored back to their land. "Therefore, behold, days are coming, saith the Lord, when it shall not be said any more, As the Lord liveth, who hath brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, but as the Lord liveth, who hath brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north and from all the countries whither he had driven them. And I will cause them to return unto their land, which I have given unto their fathers." How they would come back was also prophesied. "I am bringing them out of the northland, gathering them from the ends of the earth. Blind and lame are among them, women with child and women in travail. They come back a great company. They went away in tears, but I lead them back consoled." After Israel's regathering, however, we note that all is not tranquil. War, turmoil, and strife continue between Israel and the nations of the United Arab League. But notice how this too was precisely prophesied in the 83rd Psalm. The language of this prophecy is almost exactly that which was spoken by the United Arab League when it was founded in 1948 for the purpose of destroying Israel. "Keep not still, O God. Speak. Stir, O God. Here are thy foes in uproar. Thine enemies are alert, plotting against thy folk with cunning, conspiring against thy precious people, saying, come, let us blot them out of being, till Israel be no more a nation. And so they plan with one consent in a league against thee. Well, Psalm 83 goes on to list the location of these nations that join together in the league with the purpose of just driving Israel into the sea to her destruction. But we'd like to notice that the areas of these symbolic nations coincide exactly with the land that is now occupied by the United Arab League. Well, now by contrast with that prophecy, we'd like to note that other scriptures indicate that the present-day enmity that exists between Israel and her Arab neighbors will not continue for long. Because as you recall, Israel and the Arabs are in reality blood brothers. They are all children of Father Abraham. And prophecy indicates that all will soon be united together in a oneness of love and brotherly understanding, as brothers were meant to have for one another. Well, seeing prophecy, current day prophecy, so accurately fulfilled as we do in the United Arab League, it strengthens our faith in other prophecies of the near future, such as Amos 9:14, where God promises Israel that once he has regathered them from all the nations of earth back to their homeland and establishes them as a nation, they will never again be driven out. God speaking says, I will bring back the captivity of my people Israel, and they shall build the wasted cities and dwell there, and they shall plant vineyards and drink their wine, and they shall lay out gardens and eat their fruit, and I will plant them upon their own soil, and they shall not be pulled up any more out of their land, which I have given unto them, saith the Lord thy God. Well, as interesting as the current day fulfillment of prophecy is, we'd like to come back to our basic question. Just why was Israel regathered from the nations, and why are they called God's chosen people? Well, over 4,000 years ago, God made a promise to Father Abraham, saying, in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. And then after making the promise, God wanted to emphasize the certainty of its fulfillment, and so he confirmed it with an oath. He swore by himself that indeed, one day he would cause Abraham's seed to bless all the nations or families of the earth. What a promise. But who are Abraham's seed? Well, Abraham's seed refers to his children, his posterity. Abraham's literal seed, therefore, is none other than the nation of Israel. Abraham's literal seed, therefore, is going to, in reality, be instrumental in blessing all the families of the earth. This is the destiny that awaits Israel. But the question is, how and when will this be? Well, the role of Israel as a nation of blessing doesn't fit the past. God said in Zechariah's day that it shall come to pass, as ye were a curse among the nations, O house of Israel and house of Judah, so I will save you, and ye shall be a blessing. Well, Zechariah thus puts the time of blessing future to his day. However, we see that from Zechariah's time to the present, Israel has been a nation that has constantly been ruled over by other people. And so they were in no condition to bless themselves, let alone other people. So since this promise was not fulfilled in the past or the present, it of necessity must be yet future. Well, this brings us to the answer to our question as to why Israel was regathered. We are on the very brink of the fulfillment of one of the greatest promises ever made to man. For other prophecies go on to show that God is going to set up an earthly kingdom of blessing for all mankind, and it will take place during the lifetime of those who are living at the time Israel is regathered and established as a nation. That was back in 1948. And so it will be in our generation that God is going to set up a kingdom in which Israel will be instrumental in blessing all the families or nations of earth. Let's go on to trace a few of the promises of God that lead us to the destiny of Israel and to all mankind. Isaiah 2, 3, and 4 tells us how Jerusalem will become the capital of the world. And many people shall go and say, "Come ye, and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us of his ways, and we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord out of Jerusalem. And he will judge among the nations, and decide for many people, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning knives. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, and they shall not learn any more war." Doesn't that just thrill your hearts? Nations will not learn any more war. But a question that is still left unanswered is, what will Israel specifically do in that kingdom to bless all the peoples of earth? Well, the blessing of all people will come about through a covenant that God establishes with Israel, as referred to in the 31st chapter of Jeremiah. Under this covenant arrangement, Israel's prophets of old will be resurrected from the grave, such as Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, David, and many others. And after being resurrected, they will teach, guide, and instruct Israel in the ways of God's plans and purposes. And then Israel, in turn, having first been taught by their prophets, will go on to teach and instruct all the other nations and peoples of earth in the knowledge of God and of his plan. Eventually, all who will be rightly exercised by this kingdom arrangement will become Israelites themselves. They will actually have God's law written within their hearts. And those that do will go on to live everlastingly in God's kingdom of perfection. Let's note a few more of the hope-filled promises of God to Israel and through her to all the world. God says in Isaiah, "Be glad and rejoice unto all eternity in what I create. For behold, I will create Jerusalem for rejoicing, and her people for gladness." Zechariah continues, "Thus hath said the Lord of hosts, in those days it shall happen that 10 men out of all the languages of the nation shall take hold. Yea, they shall take hold of the skirt of him that is a Jew, saying, Let us go with you, for we have heard that God is with you." And another hope-filled promise of Isaiah, "In the future shall Jacob yet take root. Israel shall bud and blossom, and shall fill the face of the world with fruit." It almost sounds too good to be true, doesn't it? But remember, God promised Abraham with his very oath that one day his seed would bless all the families of the earth. Well, as you think of that promise, you begin to wonder, just how could that be? All the families of earth would be blessed? Because we realize that most of the families of earth are gone. They have died long ago. Are they in this promise? Is there any hope for them? Well, yes, when God promised Abraham all would be blessed, he meant all, and he made provisions for them. The scriptures are filled with references of how God will raise from the dead every man, woman, and child that has ever lived on the face of the earth to that kingdom of perfection. Notice how Hosea 13:14 refers to this resurrection. "I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. O death, I will be thy plague. O grave, I will be thy destruction. Yes, all men will be redeemed from death, or in other words, will be brought back from the dead, and death itself will ultimately be destroyed. And then notice how this kingdom of God will be one of perfection here on the earth. They shall not hurt nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. In that kingdom, man will be given an opportunity to truly know and understand God and come into harmony with his principles. Now man has experienced sin and evil with its consequences of pain, sorrow, and death. But in that kingdom, there will be no more sorrow, sickness, or pain. The perfection of that kingdom will give man an everlasting contrast lesson between good and evil. A lesson that could not be gained in any other way. In that kingdom, Isaiah 25 tells us that God will destroy death to eternity, and the Lord Eternal will wipe away the tears from off all faces, and men will say on that day, "Lo, this is our God for whom we have waited, that he would help us. This is our God for whom we have waited. We will rejoice and be glad in his salvation." Today, Israel is being transformed from a parched wilderness into prolific farmland. But this is just the beginning of the time that Isaiah describes in the 35th chapter. The wilderness and the parched land shall be glad, and the desert shall blossom as the rose. Then shall the eyes of the blind be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb shall sing. And the ransom of the Lord shall return with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. What a glorious promise thus awaits the children of Israel and all mankind. However, before these blessings take place, Israel must yet endure a very trying experience. For other prophecies go on to show that Israel will experience an overwhelming attack upon her just prior to the setting up of God's kingdom. The setting for this final attack is given to us in Ezekiel the 38th and 39th chapters. God speaking to the enemy says, "In the latter years you will go against the land that is restored from war, the land where people were gathered from many nations upon the mountains of Israel, which had been a continual waste." And so the time period is in the latter years after Israel has been regathered. And then an indication who the principal enemy will be is given in verse 14. "Thus says the Lord God, on that day when my people Israel are dwelling securely, you will bestir yourself and come from your place out of the uttermost parts of the north." We can easily surmise who the enemy will be that is north of Israel, especially when other prophecies indicate they will be an atheistic people. The fact that at that time Israel is referred to as a land that is restored from war, a land where there is no walls or bars or gates, seems to indicate that the present-day hostilities that exist between Israel and the Arabs will have come to an end, that there will be peace and tranquility between them, and a love, a brotherly love of understanding, prior to this time when the enemy comes from the north. Well, this brings us to the question, just why is God going to bring this additional trouble upon Israel after he has regathered them from the nations, watched over and blessed them? Why more trouble? Well, the scriptures bring out two basic reasons. First, in the midst of the battle, when it looks like Israel will be about to be destroyed, God will miraculously intervene on Israel's behalf and completely overthrow the enemy. That miraculous intervention will be so outstanding that all men on the face of the earth will realize that once and for all, that indeed there must be an Almighty God. As we read in Ezekiel 39, "And I will display my glory among the nations, and all the nations shall see my punishment that I execute, and my hand that I lay on them." And the second purpose for this trouble is for Israel's direct benefit. For the scriptures indicate that not all who are merely born Israelites will automatically be recipients of God's blessing. No, but rather only those who will have faith in God, who will be striving to develop a character pleasing to Him, will be considered true Israelites and members of Abraham's seed. And this final trouble, in God's miraculous intervention, will help to develop the qualities of heart necessary for Israel to be teachers and blessers of others. Ezekiel says, "The house of Israel shall acknowledge that I am the Lord their God from that day and forward. They will know that I am the Lord their God, because I, who sent them into exile among the nations, will bring them together again on the soil of their own land and leave none of them behind. And I will not hide my face any more from them, for I will have poured out my spirit over the house of Israel, saith the Lord eternal." Well, following the battle and the pouring out of God's Spirit will come the desire of all people, the kingdom of God, and the blessings of all the families of the earth. Thus, it is comforting to me that the events that are happening in Israel today and those that will happen in the near future are by the direct, overruling providences of God. It will be these experiences that will help to develop and prepare Israel for the great work of that kingdom. What a grand and glorious privilege thus awaits the children of Israel, those who will study His word, who will desire to learn what His will is for them, and then will conform their lives in harmony with it as God's chosen people. For those who would like to study further, the promises and prophecies of God to Israel found in the Hebrew Scriptures, would like to invite you to send for a free copy of the booklet, "The Time to Favor Zion Is Come." Trace the prophecies step by step as they lead to the destiny of Israel and of all mankind.
To get your Time to Favor Zion booklet, write to the address on the screen, or call toll-free 1-800-GOD'S-PLAN. The toll-free number again, 1-800-GOD'S-PLAN.